Good morning. Welcome to service this morning. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. Let's don't forget prayer Monday evening at 6 p.m. Everyone is encouraged to participate in that. Also, if you would like to participate in the annual Coastal Pregnancy Center Baby Bottle Fundraiser, please sign up and take as many baby bottles as you wish and fill them up and return them back to church. And you can take one, fill it up, come back and sign out another one. So as long as we get them all filled up with money for the Coastal Pregnancy Center. Yes, ma'am. Okay. Cancel that. The baby bottles have not arrived to the building yet. We will get them next Sunday, and we'll kick this thing off next Sunday. All right, Upper Room Prayer at 5:30 on Sunday evenings. Everyone is encouraged to participate in that. Young at Heart, there'll be a Young at Heart gathering in Kinley this Thursday, August 17th, beginning at 10 a.m. We will leave the church at 8:15. I guess there's a sign-up out there if you plan to go to that. Get signed up for that. Family game night and lock-in, that's going to be August the 18th through the 19th, starting at 6 p.m. We want the whole family to come out for games and a good time. We'll be having hot dogs for dinner. Family night will end around 8 p.m. Our lock-in will go from 8 p.m. to 10 a.m. the next morning, and the kids, this is for kids K through 12, and we ask that parents do not spend the night with their kids during the lock-in. All right, updated. Security team will be looking for volunteers to assist with security. This is open to men and women. We need armed and unarmed positions, so I guess Brother Kenny will decide if you're going to be armed or unarmed. I don't know. Anyway, if you're interested, please talk to Brother Kenny. He's got his phone number in here, and we'll be having a training session for security on August the 19th. New members should meet at the church at 10 a.m. Current members should meet at the church at 11:30 a.m. So we will have a firing session for all armed members at 1 p.m. So that means next August 19th at 1 p.m. get somewhere safe because they're going to be firing. All right, grief share is going on. It's beginning August the 1st. It's going to go through the 31st, and that's on Tuesday nights from 6:30 to 8:30. Sister Yvonne Waters is leading this these sessions. So if you have any questions, talk to her.
Amen. Glory to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. So good to be in the house of God this morning. Wow. We could be anywhere, but we chose to be here. Hallelujah. And He is faithful. When we make a choice for Him, He is going to bless. I'm telling you. I'm just waiting to see what He's going to do here today. Prayer requests that are written down. Philip Wingate, who is the one that's building our new sound booth and helping install the sound system here. Brother Craig told me this morning he's having a procedure on his heart Tuesday morning. He's got a hole in his heart, so sounds like it's fairly serious. Brittany Riggs says her coworker Thelma had a stroke and is in the nursing home. Pray for healing. Laura Dupenthaley in Florida has ovarian cancer. The mother is requesting prayer from our church. And I like this. Prognosis is not good, but God is able. Hallelujah. Have you ever been there? The prognosis is not good. Hallelujah. But our God is able. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You have a request you'd like to give this morning by raising a hand. Hallelujah. He's God of heaven. He's God of earth. Hallelujah. He's God of everything. Let's stand and pray to Him this morning. Hallelujah. Oh God, we come before You this morning. God, we know, Father, when the prognosis is not good, but You're able. Oh God, it brings joy to our heart, comfort to our soul, Father. Oh God, we just pray, Father. Oh God, for these needs today, God. Oh God, every need that's been given by spoken voice, by a lifted hand. God, You know the urgency of each one. God, You know those that are out in sin today and closest to hell. Dear God, we just pray, Father. Dear God, that You would just grab them this morning, Father. Let Your Holy Spirit arrest them this morning. Dear God, and bring them to the cross of Calvary. God, we pray that the backslider would come home today, Father. Dear God, that prodigal coming up the driveway, he would pick up his step and start running toward home. Dear God, we thank you, Father, for all that you've done. We thank you for the power of God that we feel in this place right now. Dear God, draw us, Father, God, to the altar. Draw us, God, to your presence. Oh, God, like a moth to the flame, Father. God, we just pray, Father, for these needs, God, for every person here today, God. Do a mighty work, Father. Oh, God, we pray for an anointing, Father. Dear God, that will destroy the yokes in people's lives today. Dear God, that the captive will be set free. Dear God, those that are bound, oh God, with problems in their mind, with the confused emotions, God, we speak liberty to them right now in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we praise you, Father, going not knowing, God, that you are able. All things are possible to them that believe, God. Father, we trust to believe in you. Oh God, we praise you. And the church said, amen and amen. Remain standing, let's sing and worship.
Behold, he comes. shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee.
Yes,
and out of Zion's hill salvation comes.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. So lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
Come on and give the Lord praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, glory. Oh, praise his name. Amen. You can be assured. Just as sure as you're standing or sitting here today, behold, he comes, amen. A promise from God. I'm so glad that the Lord is not like we are, amen. We can make a promise. We can mean to keep it. Things may come up that we are out of our hands and we may not be able to do what we say we're going to do. But the Lord himself one day will descend from heaven with a shout, amen. I'm looking forward to his return. I'm ready. Amen. Anybody ready to see the Lord? Amen. Tonight, today. Amen. Would you stand? We want to lift the offering this morning and thank the choir and the praise team for that rousing rendition. Amen. Behold, he comes. It is such a pleasure and honor to have you with us here this morning at Alligood Church of God. And we come as we take our offering up. We talk about we give sacrificially. We give joyfully and we give intentionally. I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about finances. I've just learned over my 30 plus years of now serving the Lord that God has met every need that the Bateman family has had. If he's met your need, would you give him praise? Amen. Hallelujah. Also, Brother Craig, if you don't mind, put up that slide real quickly. We're starting something on September the 3rd. It's called a New Beginnings class. I know you're standing, won't take you but just a moment. This is for our new converts. It's also for those that are new in the Lord. It really don't matter what age you are, but we're going to start this. It will be during this Sunday school hour at 10 o'clock in the conference room. It's also going to be a discipleship class. So if you want to grow in your relationship with the Lord, if you want to learn more about what we do here, how we do it, why we do it, and you want to progress in the things of God. So this class will be open for that, and it'll probably run 8 to 10 weeks. We'll take a break and then start it back again. So it's called the New Beginnings class. It's going to be, again, discipleship. It's for those that are brand new in the Lord. It's for those that want to grow in the Lord. It's not meant to take you away from your Sunday school class, but it's to give you another opportunity to learn more about the Lord and also about why we do what we do here at the Alligood Church of God. So be aware of that. We'll be announcing that as the days and weeks go on. So amen. How many of you glad to be in the Lord's house this morning? Amen. Good to be here. God bless you. Let us bow our heads as we prepare to present the offering and the tithe to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful again this morning for the opportunity. I say it all the time, Lord, the privilege to be in your house this morning. We're so thankful, God, that you're the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, but also the God of us, Lord. And we're so thankful, Lord, today that we felt your presence in the singing of the songs, the worship, God. And Lord, we know, Lord, as you prepare us to hear the word of God today, Lord, bless that part of it. God, bless our young people in the back, Lord, our children's churches that's going on, our staff back there. We just thank you and praise you for that next generation, that Joshua generation, that Jeremiah generation that you're raising up in our young people, Lord. And today, take this offering and let it be a blessing to the kingdom of God. And everybody said amen. You're welcome to get out of your seats. We have buckets up in the front and those in the back. May God bless you as you give.
Amen. Thank you for the way that you give and our offerings. Great spirit here this morning. Brother Tool is going to come around and bless our hearts this morning. Going to be singing a song that's one of my favorites, brother. Carrie Underwood might hit a higher note, but she ain't got the spirit you got, brother.
When I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars and I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. That God, His Son not sparing, sent Him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burdens gladly bear. He bled and died to take. We'll stop right here. Nothing bothers me worse than to see images of Jesus on the cross with a little red dot on that palm and a little red dot on that palm and a little red dot on his feet. He's clean. He's in a white little linen cloth, almost looking peaceful. That is not the cross. That's not what Jesus did for me and you. That's not the price he paid to take away our sins. This song said he bled and died. He was beaten to a pulp, almost beyond recognition. That was the cross. The cross was bloody. It was violent. It was gory. It came after the scourging that almost killed him at the scourging post. His flesh was exposed, bones exposed. It was an atrocious sight. His song said he bled and died. So as we sing this verse again, let's get that image of Jesus in our mind. And that's not Jesus today. Jesus rose from that grave. Jesus is at the right hand of the Father in heaven today, interceding for you and me. But the price he paid so that we could be here today and have the privilege to worship him in spirit and in truth was paid on that cross. So let's get that image and think about the sacrifice he made as we sing this verse again. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, he sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross my burdens gladly bear. He bled and died to take away my sin. When I think about it, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come, it didn't end on the cross. It didn't end on the cross. He's coming back. There's coming a day when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart, and I will in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. And then sings my soul,
worship the Lord together in His house. Amen. Standing in the for the reading of the word. Thank y'all this morning. Amen. My. You know, I wish I could sing like some of these folks up here. Amen. But when I sing that, how great thou art, it sounds good to me coming out of you, coming out of me. Amen. There's just something that I think the Lord allows us to sing just a little bit better when we say, how great thou art. Amen. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 8. Welcome again. We bless you in the name of the Lord, and we pray God will help us today as we try to rightfully divide the word of truth here. I'm going to preach a message that the Lord gave me, and I hope it'll be a help to you. I hope it'll be a blessing to you. But I really hope it'll challenge you. I really hope that you hear what the Lord wants to say, I believe, to the church. I'm going to preach a message that I believe the Lord gave me, and I titled it Touched But Not Changed. touched but not changed. Matthew's gospel, the 8th chapter, beginning with verse number 1. And when he came down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, there came a leper and worshiped him. See, the Lord Jesus already broke protocol. A leper shouldn't even have been nowhere near him. You know, when you're out in your sin, amen, you deserve wrath and the judgment of God, but God in his mercy, come on here. The leper said, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Again, the Lord wasn't supposed to touch him. Jesus put forth his hand and touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately his leprosy was clean or cleansed. If you'll bow your heads and pray with me. Heavenly Father, we've come again to the part of the service where the word of God is preached. First, Lord, I pray I decrease that you might increase. I pray, God, that I'll not be seen and that you'll be seen and heard. But, Lord, you use human beings to proclaim your word, so use me, Lord. And I humble myself under your sight, under your hand, God. And, Lord, I plead the blood of Jesus, the help of the Holy Spirit today in our lives, Lord. God, and give your people ears to hear what the Spirit wants to communicate to this church. And everybody said amen. God bless you as you're seated in the presence of the Lord. It's amazing that everywhere that the Lord went, something happened. Come on and say amen. Everything that God put his hand to through his son Jesus Christ, when the Lord touched it, something happened. I don't know about you, but miracles still excite me today. Come on here. A lot of people will say, well, you know, the days of miracles are past. Well, my response to them is that we still serve the same God. And maybe we don't see the miracles, the signs, and the wonders that they saw in the New Testament and Old Testament time, but it's the same God that rules and reigns above. And the God that we serve, if he is sovereign, he doesn't need your permission or my permission to do something powerful and great. So I'm believing today that God wants to touch every single person in this building. If you believe it, raise a hand and say amen. I believe that God wants to touch our young people, our teenagers this morning, our young adults, our middle-aged people, and our seniors, amen, because the God that we serve is not a respecter of person. It's the God that touched you before wants to touch you today. But understand, the thing that I want to preach about this morning for a little while is that God's touch is not merely so that you can feel something. God's touch is that he can change you. Amen. I remember the first time that the Lord touched me. I remember when he reached way down where I was in the pit in the miry clay, and he touched me and he put his hand upon me. I knew something had happened that day. I knew that my life would never be the same. I knew that I had experienced what the Bible talks about as being born again. I knew that I experienced that new birth, or it's like we like to say, we got saved. Amen. But I knew from that day forward, everything would be different. Something had to change. Come on and help me now. I knew that I had to change the way that I carried myself. I knew that I had to change the people that I hung around with. I knew that my lifestyle would change. And I'm afraid that we've become so enamored with the touch of God that we don't realize is that when God touches a man or a woman, a boy or girl, there has to be a change in that person's life. You know, you can't, when God touches you and God saves you, you don't act the same way. You don't talk the same way. I'm going to get a little transparent here. When I got saved, when the day I got saved, you know, the Lord cleansed up my mouth. Because, honey, I'd tell you something in a minute. I'd say some words, amen, that make a sailor blush. And I'm not trying to puff up any wicked or bad thing, but let's just be real this morning for just a little while. I had an attitude problem. I was arrogant. I was a mouthy. I would curse you out, and you know, and if you crossed me two wrong way, I'd go get somebody bigger than I was and go get him to knock you out. But when God touched me, something changed. That come on here. When God touched me, then something had to change. And I realized that, you know, God changes, touches us, and God changes us, and God helps us. But God expects us to do our part. Amen. You know, if you are an alcoholic and God saves you and God touches you, God expects you not to drink anymore. If you're a sinner and God touches you and God changes you, God expects you to quit sinning. Come on and say amen. I don't believe this hogwash, and I'm sorry, I don't even know if that's a real word. But I don't believe this hogwash or this rhetoric that you got to sin every day. Let me tell you something. If you do fail God, you have an advocate. You can cry out to God and God will cleanse you. But this belief system that every day you've got to commit a sin, I don't adhere to that, because the God that I serve, amen, is able to help me to live right. We need to say amen there a little bit louder, amen, that we believe that the God that we serve, he can change us from what we used to be into something that he wants us to be, amen. So here we see this story now that this man is cleansed, and the Lord Jesus breaks all these protocols. The leper, if you remember in biblical times, in this time frame, a leper had to announce the fact that he was unclean when he got around anybody else. It was Jewish law, and it was ceremonial law, and you were not supposed to come in contact. He was supposed to warn you. But see, sometimes you get so desperate. Sometimes you need God to move. Maybe that's somebody here today. You need God to help you today. You need God not only to touch something, but you need God to change something. You may need God to touch your marriage, but not only touch your marriage, but to change it into what God would have it to be. Maybe you need God to touch your body this morning, but you need to change something in your inside of your physical body. And I know that God is able this morning, with one touch of his hand, amen, to turn the diagnosis around, to turn the report around. Does anybody believe what I'm saying this morning, that God that we serve is still able to do these? Touch of God is always powerful. My God, if you couldn't feel the Lord a while ago when we were singing, we need to come pray you back from the dead. When we're singing, "How great thou art," something stirs in me every time I sing. When I am affirming, when I am articulating, when I am verbalizing, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Something begins to stir. The touch of God is real. Every time God would speak to the mountain, and the mountain can be removed. I like when God in creation, when he wanted a mountain, one preacher said he pulled one up. When he wanted a valley, he pushed one down. When he wanted to spread out the stars of the sky, he just flung them. Amen. Come on, somebody. When he wanted to create man, he formed the dust of the earth. I'm telling you, when God touches something, he touched the ground and a man became a living soul. But see, oftentimes we get a touch and we're satisfied with that. See, human beings, we're so emotional. We can be, you know. I know some of you love your animal lovers, and they know how to, on TV, they know how to get to you. See, I love animals too. You know, my idea of a pet, I've told you, is a turtle in an aquarium. Very low maintenance. But I've noticed that. And I watch television, and a commercial will come on, and they'll have these puppy dogs in these pounds, and they'll have these sad little eyes and this sad violin. Y'all know what I'm talking about. That sad violin music going, and why don't you send $25 a month to help out these poor little animals and rescue them. And many times in an emotional response, we will respond, and there's nothing wrong with that. Absolutely, it's a wonderful thing. But we respond to that because it appeals to our emotions. They have, through that video and through the music and through the words, the soft words that are spoken, it has motivated us to do, it's touched us, and it's motivated us to do something. And a lot of times, I remember I never saw the movie Old Yeller. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Old movie, some of you do anyway. It's a classic from the old days, and I finally watched it, and I'm not much of a movie person. I just can't sit still long enough. But I watched it toward the end when the young boy had to shoot the dog because he was rabid. And I never forgot that because a tear started running down my eye. I'm crying about an imaginary story. Come on here. I mean... some of y'all, you know, I remember back in the day, folks watch a soap opera and somebody die on a soap opera and they'd request prayer for them the next Sunday. That's actually happened. And so as human beings, we are very emotional. When that young boy shot, it had to shoot his dog because he had rabies. It touched my heart. I'm a grown man. I'm like, wow. You know, it just proves how emotional that we are and what happens. And here's where I'm getting to my point in my sermon. You're probably saying, hurry up. We come to church and God touches us and we have an emotional response to the presence and the power of God. We can sing a song and it'll touch us. We can hear a testimony. Somebody can get up and testify that the Lord has touched them and brought them out. I could bring somebody in who's been delivered maybe from alcohol addiction or a heroin addiction that had been bound by drugs for years and years. And we hear that wonderful testimony and it touches all of us and we respond, oh, thank you, God, that you still are delivering the drug addict. You're still healing the sick. You're still delivering the alcoholic. It touches us, but then we leave the same way. Never are we changed and are we moved in our relationship with the Lord. We can have a prayer line. I believe in prayer lines. I've been in 1,000 of them. I believe that we can have a prayer line tonight and this morning, and I can call for the elders of the church and prayer warriors. And if you have a need, we'll lay hands on you. And God, I believe God can touch you. If you come down and you need God to move in a situation, we lay hands on you. We pray for you. God will touch you. But then God not only wants to touch that situation, God wants to change it. Amen. Some of us, amen, have become so lackadaisical. Some of us have become so mundane in our relationship with the Lord. We are satisfied with a touch. But I have a heartfelt cry today from the pulpit. God not only touched me, but God changed me. God not only touched me, but God helped me. God not only touched me, but God molded me into the man that you will have me to be. God helped me to be a better husband, a better father, a better preacher, a better pastor, a better human. Come on, somebody. I'm telling you, God is able to change us here today. And if God don't help some of us, we're in trouble. Sometimes, and I'm a huge, not only because I'm a preacher, I'm a huge proponent of powerful preaching. I love to hear a servant of God, man or woman of God, get up and preach something that just stirs me. Oh, my. I mean, you know, and I've shared this before. Our former pastor here, Brother Jethro, great preacher. Oh, y'all know y'all were so blessed to sit under his ministry all those years. I went to a tent revival in Plymouth, North Carolina, and he preached a message, Bind a Strong Man. Man, I heard that message. I still remember. I remember I went home and it changed my life. I was like, man, where you at, devil? You poke your head out, I'm going to put you in a headlock. You know what they do in the UFC, whatever. Put him in that sleeper and let him make him tap out. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Amen. And there have been milestones. But a lot of time, if we're not careful, a sermon will motivate us. It will challenge us. It will stir us.
But then when we leave, we're still the same. So if you hear this sermon this morning, you say, well, Brother Bateman, you know, thank you. That was good. God bless you. I'll see you the next week. You're missing the entire point of the message. God not only wants to touch you this morning, God wants to change you. Look at the person next beside you and tell them, Brother Kenny, God wants to change you. Tell somebody. Wow, Sister Lisa's over there just pointing right at Larry. But it's true. A song will move us. A sermon will move us. A testimony will move us. And we'll go out of here and we'll say, man, we felt the presence of the Lord. But has God changed you? I want God to change us this morning. Because I'm telling you, we are living in the last of the dark days, I believe, of human history. And I believe it's a time, amen, that men's faith, women's faith is going to be tried to see if we've got the goods. Amen. After having done all, I want to say today, Lord, I'm going to stand. Though all hell assail me, I shall not be moved. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Amen. We'll boldly declare at the Alley Good Church of God, we'll preach truth. We'll stand for true doctrine. Amen. We'll stand for God and the ways of God. And we will not compromise. So, some folks live, I've been there. You know, don't raise your hand, but anybody ever live paycheck to paycheck? You know, boy, you know, Friday can't get here soon enough. I've been there. Might be there again one day. I don't know. It's no shame in that. But a lot of us live touch to touch, week to week. If I can just get here and feel the Lord. I had a man, a good man I pastored one time. His way of saying it was odd to me. He said, I feel the Lord. I feel him running right down my leg. I really didn't know how to take that. But I understood what he was saying, the way the Lord manifested and touched him. That was the way he described it. You may have a different way of describing, but God this morning, amen, is trying to talk to the church and say, listen, I can do more than just touch you. I can just do more than give you something that you can respond to emotionally, amen. I can change you. I can change your personality. I can change your situation, amen. I can change your get up and go this morning. I can change your desire from living from touch to touch, amen, to being changed from faith to faith, glory to glory, victory to victory, amen. I don't know about you. I don't believe. I know God did not call us to live in defeat. He called us to live in victory. God, change. I am down. I am out. I am not victorious. Change my situation. God, I'm tired of this view. I'm in the bottom of this valley. I know that you restore my soul in the valley. But God, I need a change of address. Amen. I need to come out of this valley and go stand on a mountain somewhere. Lift up my hands and declare the goodness and the mercy of God. So God touches mankind. We're touched. And I'm telling you, I know what I'm talking about. People can serve the Lord for years and never grow in their relationship. Just as childish. Oh gosh. Brother Bateman, you better save this one for another. And I got you here and I got you right now. Come on. We can become so childish and immature in our spiritual walk that we are offended by everything. I hate to, y'all know I'm struggling when I'm using a Facebook meme for an illustration. I'm struggling. But I saw one. It says McDonald's can mess up our order 100 times and we'll keep going back. But let somebody hurt your feelings in church and you'll leave and never come back. Woo! Nate, I'm going to go home and type amen on Facebook. go to my last scripture. I know this is so simple, and I hope, and I'm a simple preacher, so this is real simple. God not only wants to touch us, He wants to change us. God wants to raise some men and women and young people and children. You say, well, Brother Bateman, I'm at the end of this thing. I got more days behind me than I do ahead of me. God can change your outlook. God can use you mightily. Your latter days will be greater than the former. That's what I pray. Here, amen. I don't want to look back over, you know, we're getting ready to celebrate 100 years of the Alley Good Church of God, and we're having a 100-year celebration over at Snow Branch Church of God camp meeting, and we look back and thank God for all the wonderful things that have transpired in those 100 years over there at the camp meeting and these 100 years here at Alley Good, amen. But I don't know about you, amen. God, you were good back then. You're the same God. You can be good today, and God, you can change us into the church that you're calling us to be in the 21st century. Come on, that's a good place to praise the Lord. Amen. I'm going to my last scripture. And they departed from Jericho, came down from Jericho. A great multitude followed him. And behold, this story is told in all the gospels. Some it just mentions one blind man. Others it mentions these two. Two blind men sitting side by side. When they heard that Jesus passed by, cried out, saying, have mercy on us, O Lord, thou son of David. They didn't call him Jesus. They knew, they had read the Old Testament that the Messiah would be called the son of David. And they knew, and they cried out. And see, this is what I wanted you to hear this morning. Maybe you felt something already, but I want you to go a little bit deeper. And I want you to cry, maybe not out loud, but in your spirit. God, you're here today. I want you to change me this morning. I know that you're not the person that you can be, because you can continually to grow in the Lord all the days of your life. Now, don't make me go get your wife and hand her this microphone. Verse 32, and the multitude rebuked them because they should hold their peace. Let me tell you something. I learned a long time ago, and if I didn't have learned this years ago, I never would have made it this far. We can't worry about what people say. Come on here. If you don't shout and you sit there like a bump on a log, they'll talk about it. If you shout at the drop of the hat, they'll say, oh, it's just emotion. If you run, oh, we're Pentecostal. I ain't ashamed of it, amen. If you take off and run the aisle, amen, they'll say, oh, he's just in the flesh. If you sit there like a bump on a log, they'll say, well, you hindered the spirit. I've been in this thing long enough. I don't care what other people say, amen. I want to please God. Come on, somebody. They're going to talk about you anyway, amen. Let us plead God. These two blind men said, son of David, have mercy. They were saying, be quiet. People don't want you to change. They don't want you to move higher in God, because they're satisfied where they are. But I hope there's some people here this morning, amen, that will lift up the hand and say, God, that's me, Lord. You touched me this morning, God. I want you to change me today too. Verse 32. Jesus stood still and called them, what will ye that I should do unto you? That's the kind of God we serve. What do you need? I can do it. Y'all didn't hear me. He can do it. Nothing too hard for God. You need a loved one saved? God can change that situation. So you got a child or grandchild, and maybe a alternate lifestyle that the world is embracing and celebrating and saying how wonderful it is, and you know it's an abomination before God, and you're praying, God, oh God, change their hearts. Change their mind, Lord. Bring them up out of that debauchery. Bring them up out of that confusion. Come on, help me now. Bring them up, amen. Anybody know a man that can, amen? I said, does anybody know a man that can? He can, not only can he reach down and touch them where they're at, amen. God can reach down and change that situation. Read an article just yesterday. Police officer down in Florida somewhere arrested a man, 61-year-old man, ripping and roaring and selling dope and running from the law. He's drunk, got all kind of dope on him. He's got fentanyl on him. And while the man's arresting the perpetrator, the fentanyl somehow exposes itself to the police officer, and his legs go numb, and he's got to go to the hospital and all of this. And we look, or I say that because everywhere we look, we see the effects of drug addiction in our society. Listen to me one more time. I know you're tired of it, but we're living in an age where that has become an epidemic. I broke that down for you. Epidemic. It is becoming so widespread. Our young people and even middle-aged and older people are dropping dead. Inner cities. Has anybody looked at the news lately? The inner cities. Every city has a section where there's open air drug market going on, and there are people who have turned into zombies that live on the street, and all they do is get high every day, and their lives are in such a disarray. And I don't know if it breaks your heart. It breaks my heart, because I'm telling you, the church has a message of a man, amen, that came 2,000 years ago to set the captive free. You don't have to be that way, because the God I serve not only can touch you, but can change you, amen, and set you on the right path. Come on, somebody, and lift your hands and say amen. So these two men cried out. They've been hushed, they've been shushed, and they cried out the more. And the Lord says, what can I do for you? Let's go to verse 34. I need my musicians and singers, and all of you would come back. We're going to have an altar service. I'm going to believe that God's going to confirm his word this morning. See, some of you, Lord, just, I'm telling you, some of you have been stuck in the same place so long that you're comfortable there. And you're fine. You don't even... You might even say after service, you might shake my hand, pat me on my back. Man, I appreciate that preaching today. No, don't do that. Examine yourself. Look inside and have a moment of self-reflection and what I believe is introspection. You say, God, is that man talking to me this morning? Yeah. Yeah. Because God not only wants to touch you, God wants to change you. Everybody in me, everybody here, God wants to change you. God, listen, God never called anybody to be a part-time Christian. You're either in this thing or you're not. You're fooling yourself if you think that you can ride the fence, straddle the fence. You can't do, you either got to get all in. Surrender, sacrifice. The Bible talks about our bodies are as a living sacrifice. So Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes. I love this part. Anybody love a miracle, a good ending? I love a happy ending. Immediately, they received their sight. God touched them. They get a miracle. The last passage of this scripture is what I want you to hear more than anything else I'm saying, except that God wants to change you. They followed him. Throw aside the garments of a beggar, of a blind man, and put on the robes of the redeemed. I believe God's speaking to people this morning. You've followed Him, or you've observed from afar. You've been touched, and you can go back to a place where God touched you and helped you, maybe even changed you. But you stayed there. And I believe God's calling some people. Everybody's not going to hear me, I know that. But God's calling some of you to a radical life in Christ. What is that, preacher? Well, my favorite illustration. Somebody said, well, you can't get too radical in this thing. People think you're crazy. My favorite illustration, the Green Bay Packers play in Wisconsin. And a lot of times their football games are played in below zero temperature in a driving snowstorm. And inevitably, there will be some idiot who's sitting in the stands without a shirt on, cheering for his team. I'm sure he's had about 22 Budweisers. But now, the rest of the 70,000 that are there, not all of them are drinking. So if you can fill up a football stadium with 70,000 people in below zero temperature to cheer for a football game. Now, I'm going to tell you something. You go to whatever, I can't think of the town that they're in Wisconsin. You go there and you talk bad about the Packers, you're going to get beat up. They say it's almost like a religion in Wisconsin. I'm not asking you to stand in below zero temperature in a driving thunderstorm with your shirt off. I'm asking you to let God change you and to live for the Lord radically. Radically, I want you to stand. I want you to bow your heads this morning. He's not too busy to hear your heart's cry. Listen now. Oh, he's passing by this moment. Oh, your needs to supply.
Reach out and touch the Lord.
If you'll reach out this morning, God not only will touch you, but God will change you. I want these altars to feel. Come on, everybody that can or would. Come on here. Let's ask God to touch.